Will?
Present.
Senator Leyva?
Here.
Senator Roth? Assemblymember O'Connell?
O'Donnell is here.
O'Donnell, I'm sorry. Assemblymember Cunningham?
Here.
Assemblymember Burke?
Here.
Juan Morales?
Here.
Jeremy Smith?
Here.
Anna Lasso?
Present.
And Gail Miller?
Here, great. Thank you so much. We have a quorum. Pursuant to the governor's executive order N2520 from March 12th, 2020, the meeting is being conducted by way of teleconference. It's being physically webcast from room 6300 at 707 3rd Street in West Sacramento for anyone that would like to provide public comment in person. In order for the meeting to run efficiently, please note the following guidelines. All participants will be muted during the meeting. If a board member or the public would like to make a comment, please use the raised hand feature in Zoom meeting, and I will call your name at the appropriate time. If you have updated to the latest version of Zoom, that's under the reactions tab, and then you just hit the raise hand. If you are calling into the meeting and not using the Zoom app, unfortunately, you will not be able to provide public comment. And the first action item are the minutes from the June 23rd, 2021 meeting. Are there any questions or public comments? Seeing none, may we have a motion and a second to approve the minutes?
Moved.
Moved by Senator Wilk, seconded by Senator Leyva. Seeing no public comments, Mr. Guardado, can you please call the roll?
Yes, Senator Wilk?
Aye.
Senator Leyva?
Aye.
Senator Roth? Assemblymember O'Donnell?
Aye.
Assemblymember Cunningham?
Aye.
Assemblymember Burke?
Aye.
Juan Morales?
Aye.
Jeremy Smith?
Aye.
Anna Lasso?
Aye.
Gail Miller?
Aye. The minutes are approved. Thank you. The next item is the executive officer statement, please, Ms. Silverman.
Aye. Well, we have lots to report tonight, so we just wanted to provide some updates related to our budget. And as a result of the governor's budget being signed, we have some great news for the program. So we're happy to announce there's $490 million. And that was the this expansion of the full-day kinder program. So now it also includes the California State preschools and transitional kindergartners. So super excited about that opportunity, and we're actually going to have stakeholder meetings beginning September 8th. So again, looking out for some more opportunities for funding. So please participate in this process. And the second item we wanted to share with the board is, as you didn't follow, there's $250 million additional from the general fund that's going to be allocated for new construction and modernization projects this year. So we're super excited about that funding opportunity. General fund money coming to the program, we'll welcome that anytime. So again, we will have some additional guidelines presented at the September board meeting. And we also have a facility inspection tool that we actually will be updating as well. And that tool will be used effectively with school districts July 1st of 2022. So during that process of updating and having revisions, we'll be working with the stakeholder community, and our first meeting will be September 30th. So we're looking for some input, and we anticipate a few meetings related to the inspection tool update. And the next item we wanted to share is the apportionments that were provided in March. So the board did award nearly $520 million in cash to projects. So with that, we had a July 27th deadline. And since we didn't have a board meeting in July to report, but we're happy to share that it was over $347 million that were allocated, plus an additional $1.8 million that didn't require a fund release request. So if those folks who didn't come in for their cash, they may have a new date to their project. If it's a second strike, they actually do lose their project apportionment. So to that extent, we wanted to provide some updates with related to the release of cash. And we actually had a filing round for the certification that actually closed June 10th. And we're happy to share there's over $766 million in requests that came in. So that's great news for folks who are waiting for the fall bond sale. So again, that's $766 million in unfunded approval requests for the certification round. And we do have a fall bond sale to announce. So the week of September 12th, we'll be coordinating with the treasurer's office, and that bond sale expects to close on the 20th. And to that extent, we'll be bringing those apportionments to the board in October. And again, those certifications that came in are valid from July 1st through December 31st. So again, those projects that came in for the cert are valid for the bond apportionments in October. And we have some additional news with the virtual training announcements. We actually had on August 3rd, the financial hardship training program that was also a workshop online. And to that extent, we, for folks who wanted to know about the eligibility requirements for the financial hardship program and how to qualify for additional program funds if you don't have a match, that was a great opportunity for folks to learn some more education in that area. And to that extent, I know there is, we actually had 90 external folks that joined us, which is great news. And again, we're actually happy to report that we have over 825 external participants since the beginning of January. And this is the 12th workshop we held. And we have another workshop announcement. So that is actually September 9th. And that workshop really entails about site development worksheets. And that's the cost worksheets for the program and the estimates related to the facility hardship program. So some worksheets have been updated. And again, that's a great tool on how to provide cost estimates with your grant projects. And again, if you want to be successful in the program, you need to definitely know how to get these worksheets completed in a streamlined effect so you can be successful the first time through. So we're looking forward to having some more participants in this area. And actually, that was actually a stakeholder request to have this cost estimate worksheet workshop. So again, this is great news that we're actually incorporating some requests from our field. And the next thing we want to announce was there was a legal filing related on August 23rd by the Deputy Attorney General, and that's a combined appellate reply brief and cross-respondent brief to the Court of Appeals at the 4th District, and that's related to the active litigation for the Coalition for Adequate School Housing. And so we just want to provide the board an update that a brief was filed on our behalf. And our next meeting is September 22nd at 1 p.m., and I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Ms. Silverman. Any questions? Seeing none. Oh, great. Thank you so much. And we look forward to that future bond sale as well. Next, we will move to the consent calendar, Ms. Silverman.
The consent calendar is ready for your approval.
Any questions or comments?
O'Donnell moves.
Moved by O'Donnell.
Second.
Seconded by Senator Leyva. Any public comment on the consent calendar? Seeing none, Mr. Garrido, can you please call the roll for the consent calendar?
Senator Wilk?
Aye.
Senator Leyva?
Aye, sorry.
Assemblymember O'Donnell?
Aye.
Assemblymember Cunningham?
Aye.
Assemblymember Burke?
Aye.
Juan Morales?
Aye.
Jeremy Smith?
Aye.
Anna Lysel?
Aye.
And Gail Miller.
Aye, the consent calendar is adopted. Thank you. Any financial reports to report, Ms. Silverman?
Yes, on page 158, we wanted to share the release of cash, which is great news. That's tied to the March apportionments. And so combined June and July, we actually released $58.3 million plus $77.3 million in July and June. So again, pretty busy month with releasing cash. So that's great news for the program. And then on stamp page 161, we just want to draw your attention as part of the consent agenda. The board did approve over $227 million in program grants. So that's great news. We're really busy over the summer. So that's 86 projects. So that's great for the program. And we actually have about $3.1 million that came back to the program as a result of closeout. So that's all we have to report.
Great. Thank you. Thank you for all that work. And hopefully there'll be lots of schools that benefit us. All of our kids go back to school this year. With that, we all know that the appeal was postponed. We will move to Ms. Camp Minert and the potential regulations for the COVID-19 impacts on enrollment. Ms. Camp Minert?
Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. Yes, so our action item today is actually a topic that OPSC has been looking into since about this time last year, and we are happy to report that we have sufficient data at this point to bring this before the board for discussion and a potential decision. But what we are looking at here is the impact of the COVID-19 related enrollment decreases that school districts have been facing and how that connects to new construction eligibility. And what we've been hearing from districts and what we're seeing as we're processing the new construction eligibility applications is that there are more applications for more districts this year where enrollment information from 2021 being included in the enrollment projection is resulting in a loss of new construction eligibility. And for some districts, this is making it so the projects cannot move forward at all. For others, they're having to take large reductions, and others are having to consider borrowing pupil grants from other grade levels in the planned project. So we are seeing some impacts now in the item. In the attachments, we have pointed out that there are a number of factors that have come into this discussion that we've been having, because just overall in California, if you look statewide, we are seeing some declining enrollment trends, just declines in population and birth rates, and just a host of other things that are probably a factor in many of these cases. But we are also seeing some districts where they've been a growth district for a number of years, and we see growth year after year after year. And then suddenly in 2021, with the COVID-related drop, it's dropping so much that it is actually having an impact on the new construction eligibility. So what we've been doing over the past months is we've been encouraging districts to submit their enrollment-related information early if we were going to be processing them using the 2021 enrollment information. We worked last fall with any of our small school districts that had the ability to lock in their enrollment information based on the 1920 school year. They had an opportunity to lock it in for 3 years, so we were able to assist a number of districts in that manner, because in 2021, if things improved, they could always lock again, but at least we could get that 1920 number locked in. So we had done that. And now at this point, we are able to report to the board that while we're not finished processing all the applications that will use 2020 enrollment, we have the information on the majority of them. And we've included a chart on page 242 of the item. And it's referencing the number of applications and districts that were processed using this 2021 enrollment information. The number of applications, it's 92, and that's for 52 different districts. So we have some districts with multiple applications. And of that number, of the 92 applications, 45 were able to move forward, either through that three-year lock or through just the 2021 normal enrollment update. And that's just districts that had sufficient eligibility for the projects that they were requesting at this time. So they may have had a decline in enrollment, but it was not impacting the new construction eligibility. But that leaves us with 47 applications that did not have sufficient eligibility with the 2021 update to move forward in the way that they originally intended the application. So we took a look at some options for how to address this, because that was a large number of districts. And we did see that the data was showing that this does appear to be related to COVID. We can't say how much of it or with 100% certainty that it's entirely related to COVID, but we can definitely see some patterns here statewide where this is having an impact that districts otherwise would not have seen. So we started to look at some ways to fix that, explored various options with our cohort projections, landed ideally on not tinkering with the math on that too much, because it, there's some decent math behind it. We didn't want to break anything while trying to fix this particular issue. We also were looking towards what was done for school districts with the average daily attendance for purposes of the local control funding formula amounts, and also responding to what we were hearing from many stakeholders. And what we have landed on for a recommendation for the board's consideration is similar to how LCFF was treated and is what we're hearing from a lot of stakeholders as their preferred approach as well. And that is, it's basically a hold harmless. We could use the 1920 year, basically use it as the current year enrollment. So rather than changing the numbers around in the cohort, just don't require the 2020 enrollment information to be considered the current year. Have districts use 1920 if they normally would have been required to use the 2021 enrollment information. And what that does is it gets us as close as we can to current time. And so the, as you all are very familiar from appeals and past conversations. The board had wanted in 2017 to ensure that we were looking at the most accurate information that we have, which as far as updates, 2021 might not be reflective of what's really going on for school districts. So 1920 is the next time point that is closest to before the pandemic and the time period in which we were processing the application. So it gets us to a reasonable estimation of need for school districts that have these new construction projects. Now, the outcome of that, if you go to page 244 of the item, one of the things that we did discover as well in doing the research is that there was not a one-size-fits-all solution. Nothing we tried was going to be perfect for all applications, but using the 1920 information resolves quite a few of the applications that did not have eligibility. And that chart there in about the top third of the page there shows 40 of the 47 applications, 19 of them would be fully resolved by using 1920 enrollment information. So we'd be able to request their application at the original pupil grant amount that they were hoping for. An additional 16 applications would be partially resolved. So it would be able to move forward at a better eligibility level than 2021 would have been for the district, or perhaps move forward with 1920 when 2021 would not have resulted in anything for the project. So those are both great outcomes. We do show initially that 12 applications would not be resolved by this. So we know that this isn't going to be the fix for everyone. We also know that there is a chance that by using 1920 districts that would otherwise have been impacted in 2021 that may not have had eligibility even if the pandemic had not happened, we may have one or two projects that does get funded because of a 1920 solution. But we felt that it was more important to address this larger issue that was caused by the pandemic and this large number of applications that were not able to move forward. So we felt that was still the best course. So what we are recommending, if the board would like to provide some relief to districts that are facing this, we are recommending that districts be allowed to use the 1920 enrollment information as the current year when they are reporting their enrollment for purposes of new construction eligibility. And this would be for those districts that would normally be required to use 2021 per the regulations. This is a one-year fix. We are looking just at the 2021 information at this point. We don't yet have enough information about future years to know if we still have a problem with eligibility. That's certainly something we can talk about if we can certainly bring that back to the board as we get more information, but we won't have those numbers until after the official count happens in October. So that is what we are recommending. It's the best solution that we have come up with for this this unusual year, and we think it will help a lot of districts move forward with these projects.
Thank you, Ms. Kampmeiner. Mr. O'Donnell?
Yeah, just a comment. First of all, I want to just share that I appreciate that we are appreciating the impact of COVID on attendance, enrollment, et cetera, because it is real. It is real. Hopefully we'll see a change in a different direction shortly. I think a lot of it was just impacted by kindergarten, which of course is permissive, voluntary. But one thing I think we need to look at going forward as a board is the advent of TK. The legislature essentially added a grade level this year. And that is going to, or should, in my view, impact eligibility going forward too. And I don't know if staff knows today, we can have a conversation. We need to solve this today, of course, but we should have a conversation whether that's going to require statutory change to address the TK issue or a regulatory change. But again, if we can engage on that topic, not today, but maybe my office and staff could talk about that, because that is something I think we should think about.
Yeah, that's a great idea. Thank you for that. We'll take that as an action item and make sure we understand how to incorporate, now that we've added TK, I assume once fully implemented, how we include that in the enrollment data that we analyze for qualification. That's great. Thank you. Any other comments or questions? Is there any public comment on this issue? We do want to thank a lot of the stakeholders did help us in providing the data we needed from the districts, and we're really grateful that we have that. I do just want to make it clear, just in case, given that we know that not this won't solve the issue for everyone and their other circumstances, everyone is still eligible to appeal an award if they don't receive it. So this doesn't change any of it. It just tries to acknowledge that there was an issue and we tried to solve it. So I'm just making sure, Mr. Gardabato, that there's no public comment. I don't see anyone with a raised hand.
Yeah, I don't see any either. Oh.
Ms. Lasso.
I just wanted to publicly acknowledge Lisa and Barbara on their thoughtful and very thorough analysis. Barbara always provides a great presentation and makes it very clear. This is very difficult and complex data, ever-changing. So kudos to our team at OPSE.
I completely agree with that. Yay. Absolutely. It is so true. And our students are well served with the deep analysis and the thoughtfulness that goes into everything. Seeing no, Mr. O'Donnell, you don't have another question, right? Your hand is just still raised. No. Okay. May we have a motion in a second, please?
So moved.
Moved by Senator Leyva.
Second.
Seconded by Ms. Lasso. Mr. Gardabato, can you take the roll, please?
Certainly. Thank you. Senator Will?
Aye.
Senator Leyva?
Aye.
Assemblymember O'Donnell?
Aye.
Assemblymember Cunningham?
Aye.
Assemblymember Burt? Juan Morales?
Aye.
Jeremy Smith?
Aye.
Ana Lasso?
Aye.
And Gail Miller?
Aye. Ms. Burke, I don't think I heard you. Could you just give your vote one more time? Did you hear her?
Sorry, I'm having technical difficulties. Aye.
Perfect. Thank you so much. Sorry. The item is adopted. Thank you very much. And now we will look at the work ahead, Ms. Silverman, and then we will be adjourned.
Yeah, the workload reports are ready for your view. And just remind folks that we have our next meeting, September 22nd at 1:00.
Great, thank you. Are there any public comments on any of the projected workload? Seeing none, any other comments from board members? Seeing none, thank you all very much. We will work on the TK enrollment, Mr. O'Donnell, and have a great day, everyone. This meeting is adjourned. Take care. Bye.
Bye.